name is John Hamre, the president at CSIS, and it's I'm so happy that everybody could get here on such a hot day. You know, I mean, and, this is Washington, and it's this time of the year, but hopefully the air conditioning will hold out. I'll check on it, make sure that we're going to be okay. Delighted to have everyone here, and delighted to have an opportunity to explore this topic. I was talking with the ambassador, Medina Mora, just a few minutes ago, and he said, you used to have a Mexico program here, didn't you, at CSIS? We did, and that was back when Dalal Bear was with us, God rest her soul. She did a terrific job of creating a Mexico program, and we really have not caught our balance since then. So we're making up for it today by taking pieces of Mexico. We need to get together and talk about how we do all of Mexico together, but I'm glad that we could do this part. This is, we've all been anxious to hear how Mexico is going to deal with the reform agenda. And it is coming. I mean, we had thought our timing here would let us talk about the details of it, but we know that it's going to be coming, and it's an exciting thing for us. I mean, it's part of this. We want our neighbor to do well. We think energy is a big part of doing well, and we're going to listen and talk a little bit more of that today about what it could mean for all of us. And so I'd like to thank all of you for coming and joining us today. And could I ask you now, with your applause, to welcome Ambassador Medina Mora, who is going to really kick this off for real. Thank you. Ambassador.
Thank you very much. Delighted to be here, really. And yes, it is important to have CSIS to restart a Mexico program. And we were just comment through lunch that we take each other for granted, and we shouldn't. Actually, Mexico is the second largest customer of the U.S., just after Canada. And in business school, they teach you take care of your customers. You are our number one customer, so we have to really. And there is no accident in this economic integration, which is successful and ongoing. But I would like to congratulate CSIS for hosting this event and for promoting a very timely and necessary dialogue. I am very excited to be here and to be able to listen to the experts and understand their points of view on Mexico's development on the energy front and where energy in North America is headed. Just last month, I was invited to a conference in New York organized by Goldman Sachs on the North America Energy Summit. And there we had the opportunity to listen to different perspectives on the considerable economic impact of this unconventional revolution. There is a growing consensus that North America has the capability to unlock a great potential and become an energy self-sufficient region in the next 20 years. But there are very important challenges that we need to address to turn this potential into a reality, including infrastructure, regulatory issues, and the shortage of skilled workers in the industry. We have to start thinking as a region about how we are going to address these challenges together in order to facilitate this transformation, which is within our grasp. As a matter of fact, it's already here because our energy sector is very much integrated already in North America. And one of the beauties of this successful integration in terms of how we trade with each other and what we produce together is that it's not coming from a political statement, which would have been sort of difficult to manage, but from market realities. And it just makes sense and it happens. It gives the basis for companies and business people to actually go after the opportunities and make decisions and make things happen. But one of the main conclusions in this conference summit in New York was the importance of having a regulatory framework that is up to date and at the same time can be effective in the decades to come. Mexico, with a long overdue package of reforms, has dramatically updated its framework with a series of far-reaching and transformative reforms that will conclude in congressional terms, with the approval of the secondary legislation in energy sometime this summer. There is no doubt in our minds that the reforms will be approved, and of course, but there are many challenges in how these are actually structured in the fine print. These structural reforms, encompassing labor, education, telecommunications, financial services, competition policy, fiscal policy, and of course, the mother of all reforms, the energy sector, that will transform our economy in the years ahead, provided, of course, that implementation is successful. The energy reform in Mexico is certainly important, but even before it takes place, the sector remains a central component of U.S.-Mexico trade. Let me give you a couple of examples. In 2013, the United States was a destination of approximately 72% of crude oil exports from Mexico, which arrive via tanker. The value of crude oil export from Mexico to the U.S. is more than two times the value of oil exports, which were almost roughly $18 million. Mexico was a destination of 44% of U.S. exports of gasoline in 2013, 600,000 barrels per day of all products. Mexico is the third largest oil supplier to the U.S. after Canada and Saudi Arabia. We have benefited from the lower natural gas prices in the U.S. and pipeline exports to Mexico rose by 6%, a record level. Most likely, natural gas demand will continue to grow in all sectors, mainly in industry and power generation. But there is also great potential to use it as a transportation fuel. Natural gas exports from the U.S. to Mexico through pipelines will continue to increase in the years to come. We are expanding the national gas pipeline network with two main projects now under construction, which will bring natural gas from the U.S. to Mexican territory. Three more projects are scheduled to be in operation by 2015-2016. Geography has blessed the North American region with significant energy reserves. According to the latest BP Energy Outlook, North America will be the only region of the world that moves from being a net energy importer to a net exporter. So while China and Europe become more dependent on energy imports, North America is becoming self-sufficient. By 2035, North America will be a net oil exporter, accounting for 6% of global energy exports. And by 2017, the region will become a net exporter of natural gas. North America, thus, has the necessary energy resources to fuel its economic growth for a long time. And reliable and affordable energy will be a key component in ensuring a very competitive North American manufacturing base. At the end, this is the most important component of competitiveness looking towards the future. Through energy reform, Mexico will redefine its role in the energy sector, while the U.S. is adjusting to a new reality as a potential exporter of oil and gas. Increasing its energy efficiency, decreasing its consumption, and developing technology that has opened new frontiers of energy resources. This is an exciting time to discuss the future of Mexico and the region. With our reinvigorated economic engagement with the United States through the high-level economic dialogue, for the most, the bilateral relationship in terms of trade and investment and shared production and integrated value-added chains for the last 20 years has been driven in automatic pilot. Now we are now, for the first time in many years, addressing these from a public policy perspective as well, and this can be, of course, transformational. Trilateral initiatives launched at the North American Leaders Summit in Toluca last February, international engagement with Latin America through the Pacific Alliance, and with Asia via the TPP. Mexico's already significant role in the world economy has strengthened. Energy reform is a critical part of boosting prosperity, and along with the reforms currently underway in Mexico and the changes I just mentioned, will be the basis for Mexico to achieve more rapid and sustainable economic growth over the next few years and coming decades. I am looking forward to hearing your thoughts, so I will just conclude by adding that I'm very optimistic about our region opening in a new chapter of our shared vision for this future. Mexico has to address the energy reform in a very smart, intelligent way, and I'm very optimistic as well that we will be able to do so. Thank you very much.
Well, let me add my welcome to John Hamre's, to all of you for coming out and such a good crowd to welcome our visitors today. We're going to talk about the Mexican oil and gas reform, and we're very pleased that the Energy and National Security Program to co-sponsor this event with our America's program and headed by Carl Meacham. So I'm, for those I haven't met, I'm Guy Caruso, and a senior advisor to the Energy and National Security Program. And the Mexican oil and gas reform has been something that I think has been in the works for a number of years, and we're going to hear from three of the, I think, most knowledgeable people I can think of to talk about that in the order in which we're going to go. We'll start with Jesus Reyes Heroles, who is former Secretary of Energy, former Director General of PEMEX, and now in the private sector as CEO of Structura, private company in Mexico City. He's going to start and talk a bit about some of the basic elements of the oil and gas reform, and he's been right there on the ground as this has developed. And we'll start with Jesus and then follow by Pedro Haas. Pedro has had extensive experience, first of all, with PEMEX as a member of the team that was part of the gas marketing, as I recall, back in the day. And then with the private sector, and then he had a number of years in a senior position with McKinsey and Company. And so he has very deep insights into how the private sector may respond to these reforms. And I think he'll talk about some of the reforms and how the private sector might react and what the implications would be. And then finally, Ed Morse, who is the head of commodity research at the Citibank, and especially focused on, of course, oil and gas. And Ed has been one of the most, I think I would call it, most optimistic analyst, most optimistic among those who have looked at the North American energy scene and put it into the global context. I think Ed may have been the first person who actually projected that North America would be a net oil and gas exporter, and this is several years ago. So I'm sure we're going to hear even more from Ed about how now these new Mexican oil and gas reforms feed into that kind of analysis and his latest outlook for North America and its integration into global oil and gas markets. We talked a little bit earlier about how the unconventional oil and gas successes we've had in both the U.S. and Canada certainly are part of this story. And then now we're going to hear how the Mexican oil and gas reform may fit into that North American picture. And certainly we will we're going to hear about it from some of the most knowledgeable people I can think of. And we're going to start with Jesus, and then we'll follow right without delay to Pedro, then Ed, and then we'll have plenty of time for questions and answers from the audience. So,
okay,
thank you very much for coming, Jesus.
I will try to sort of lay the ground for the discussion that we will have later on. For some of you, some of the things I'm going to present may be already knowledge, but I think it's basic for all of them to know what is the essence of the reform and then proceed into the exchange of points of view. I didn't do it before, so let me see if somebody... I don't use this one, or what? All right, okay, this is easy. All right. This is easier than this. All right. First, in terms of discussing energy issues in North America, really it was very, very difficult. And many friends in this room and I did discuss about this or tried to discuss about this for years. But it was really basically an empty discussion. It was a diplomatic discussion, and there was an impossibility to discuss further interaction in energy because interactions do exist and are very significant, and any kind of policies for the future, because Mexico couldn't. Basically, it had no leeway, no space to discuss in a more market-oriented and more from a business perspective the future of energy relationships in North America. However, the constitutional amendments that were passed by President Peña only last December are really a game changer in regard to that. Now, private investment will be allowed in Mexico. Energy sector is, and it will be possible in every aspect of the hydrocarbons change and further in the electricity sector. And this opening of Mexico after long discussions since 1938 about all this happens when there is a revolution going on in the US, also in terms of energy with all the shale hydrocarbons, and also when Canada is sort of collecting some of the benefits of the consistent, what I would call a relatively consistent and steady energy policy over the past decades, I would say. So there is a major change now in the North American scenario. Now, the Mexican energy reform has a logic for itself, for the energy sector, but it is more than that. The Mexico's energy reform is absolutely central for Mexico's energy economic policy. I mean, Mexico has been growing very slowly over the past 10, 15 years. And it's really a paradox paradigm. You have a country where inflation is low, you have had financial stability for so many years, but the country simply is not growing. And this government knows very well that one of the critical factors is to increase significantly investment in Mexico, both public and private, and both domestic and foreign. And for that to happen, obviously, the energy sector is critical. It is the energy sector who has the capacity to attract a lot of investment. And also, for a higher growth to happen in Mexico, you need a more efficient energy sector, because it's implications in the rest of the economic in the rest of the economy. So both, because it is central to increase total investment, and both because it has efficiency implications. The energy reform is central for Mexico's for Mexico and for President Peña Nieto's administration. Now, what is the essence of the reform? It is a very deep and far-reaching reform. It basically, it sounds simple, but it's a complete change, historically speaking. It eliminates the exclusivity on PEMEX on the entire hydrocarbon chain. Some of us, and in other times, thought that probably we could get some reform, but nobody really dreamed about this. This is really getting as far as possible. It's opening up to the extreme the sector. You will have private parties then concurring with the public sector. Pemex will not disappear, National Oil Company will not disappear, and that is not the purpose. The purpose is basically saying we want to maximize the resources allocated to the hydrocarbon sector of Mexico. And up to now, that had been limited because Mexico's framework, legal framework, constitutional framework, basically said only one agent will be responsible of exploiting the hydrocarbons in Mexico, and that agent is Pemex. And with time, it was obvious that Pemex, and even the Constitution went further because it was not, it's you, Pemex, who has this privilege, but at the same time, you have to do it all by yourself, which was a complete anomaly in the world. I mean, if you see other national oil companies, they don't have the prohibition of partnering with somebody else to do some of the many things that the national oil companies have to do, integrated national oil companies. In Mexico, it was an oddity, and that was really very limiting to the development of the hydrocarbon sectors in Mexico. Now, it allows Pemex to partner with whomever it wants, in some cases with a majority stake, not established in the law, but according to Pemex's interests and commercial and business interests. And it can do it in a very flexible way, completely flexible way. That is really what the reform, one of the issues that the reform encompasses. This change is so radical that it will obviously shake up the PEMEX, and it will transform it and make it really move much faster, because now change is a matter of life or death to PEMEX. I mean, in the past, it was really impossible to make PEMEX move. The protection to the company was so big, to its monopolistic position, that the incentives for the company and for the people in the company to move in a different direction were limited. Now, in my view, there is a caveat in the reform, and there's something I still don't understand why the government did not include that. And that is that they kept PEMEX within the budget. I mean, in previous lives, some of us had really pushed forward in terms of saying one relatively easy and far-reaching change is to take PEMEX out of the budget. Because the problem is, it's not only the government take, because that's the taxing issue and the royalties, let me put that aside. The problem is all the red tape and all the presence of governmental agencies that intervene in day-to-day decisions within the company. And the government did not do that. I worked in the Treasury for 8 years some time back, and I know that the people in the Mexican Treasury are control freaks. And they really have an against underscore that they still are the same way they have been for the past, since the Mexican Treasury was born. And if you see in this reform, in my way, a critical issue is that there is too much intervention of the Treasury in many of the decisions that should be have left to PEMEX by itself without the intervention of the Treasury. The other thing is the reform also reaches the electricity sector. It allows the participation in generation for third parties. The private sector is already the Mexican electricity sector. You have IPPs. And you have a lot of other activities done for CFE, but now you will basically, the change allows private parties to get in contact as providers, suppliers of electricity, with the consumers, big consumers, what they call the qualified consumers, which is basically a matter of size. And they would also allow for other companies for the CFE, which is a national utility, to outsource several of the things that were limited I mean, they had to do it by themselves. Now they will be able to, the private sector will be able to finance, install, maintain, manage, operate, and expand transmission and distribution infrastructure by means of contracts with the utility. It sounds a minor change, but it's a major change, because then what you will see is a very significant increase in the efficiency of operational efficiency of the CFE due to the possibility of relying on private parties. This basically gives you a notion of the speed, the pace at which the reform will move forward. And I will not stop a lot of time here. Obviously, the constitutional reform was enacted in December last year. PEMEX started, the first step was for PEMEX to request in what areas or fields or place where PEMEX is already working or has intention to do so, the PEMEX would like to stay. PEMEX did so in last March. Then the government sent 21 initiatives to Congress to change 21 different laws, to change or even some new laws. You have then in September, the areas will be defined. What areas will PEMEX keep will be defined by the government in it's a decision of the government, of the state, of the Mexican state, and that will be September 17. It's already it's a mandate in the Constitution. And then you will have other things moving, like the creation of Mexico's Energy Fund, but it's a very important thing is that the Constitution mandates that the National Energy Regulatory Commission has to define the rules and regulations that will apply to the transportation and warehousing of fuels, and that will have to be there. Those regulations will have to be there for January of next year. So this is one of the areas where there is a huge need for additional investments. There are many bottlenecks in the Mexican system because PEMEX was not allowed to invest in the past in expanding its network of fuel pipelines and warehousing facilities. So it's really, I would say, almost an emergency that has to be dealt very quickly, and a lot of investment opportunities will emerge for the private sector as part of that. And there are other important changes will come along over the next few years. And you can even see December of 2025, and that is because it is for then that the domestic content of the energy projects will have to reach 35%, which is a very in Mexico it was very curious. PEMEX was not had not long-term relationships with a lot of suppliers and EPC companies, because the way the procurement of Mexican public sector entities did not allow for PEMEX to establish a long-term relationship with a lot of its suppliers and EPC companies. Now there is this 35% will be defined will be enacted for 2025. It will be enacted gradually. So you have 12 reforms and nine new laws. Now, what is in the very, very short term the first priority? And that is to basically address Mexico's gas deficit that increased very, very speedily since 2008. Fuels deficit is increasing since 2003. There are many bottlenecks in the capacity for Mexico to import from the U.S. now that the U.S. Is gradually becoming a net exporter of gas. We have been importing gas from the U.S. for quite some time. The ambassador mentioned that before. But this is the most urgent thing. Actually, it's going on because the gas sector was opening in 1992, and the first investments were done in 1996, 97. So these are the pipelines that are being now under construction, and this is where a lot of activity is already going on. You can see on the eastern part of Mexico, a very very important one called Los Ramones. It's a big pipeline. It goes to the center to San Luis Potosí. It's a 850 kilometers, and it's a $3.2 billion project. It's already under construction. It's very important. And also in the center and in the west, the national utility, the CFE, is building all these pipelines that you can see there in the map. And there are six more coming up, will be announced over the next 2 weeks, let's say, in the next weeks, which will really create a network of gas pipelines in Mexico, because now it's not really a network. What it is a couple of branches that come, some from the north, importing gas from the US, and some from the south, bringing to the north, to the center and to the north, where the economic activity and industry is. The gas that Mexico produces mostly in the south eastern part of the country. Now, this is a simple, well, I'll try to put it in as simple as possible, the investment opportunities that emerge in Mexico with the reform. And in the horizontal axis, you can see the complexity of the projects, and the complexity is associated with the time that it will take for these projects to materialize. That you know, you can see that the things are happening. And in the vertical axis, you have the amount of investment of the different projects. So you can see, for example, what we were talking about, gas pipelines. It's already there, it's happening, it's not a matter of the future, and they're expensive. I mean, pipelines are not an inexpensive project, so you require that. But you will, the coal seam gas in Mexico, there's no production of coal seam gas. And it will be possible for private parties to produce that the day after the legislation is, the secondary legislation is passed, and it is expected to happen within this month. So the day after that, immediately coal seam project, coal seam gas production projects will emerge. And so I will give you the list in a minute, but you can see to the in the northeastern quadrant of the graph, you can see obviously 17 is up because it will take more time to see the things happening in terms of deep water, and it will require a lot of resources. But things that we have to, the purpose of this graph is really seeing that what has been triggered with the constitutional reform is a process. And it is a process that will show up first in some activities and in some other activities, depending of their complexity and of the constitution and the legal reforms themselves. You can see 16, heavy oil, exploration and production in shallow waters. It's it's less expensive, and it's sooner. It will be sooner. We didn't put a year in each of those, but you could basically think that each of those panels correspond to about a year. It's not exact. It's impossible to really do a precise exercise. But you can see, let's say, 1, 2, 3, the fourth. In the south, in the southwestern panel, you can see that there you have a lot of activities already, 8, 23, 12, etc. What do they mean? It's here. This is the codes of this. So you can see from gas pipelines that are open now, and then you'll see fuel stations until 2017. This is still discussed, is being discussed in the Congress, because people think it's too far away, that a lot of congressmen really want to shorten that period. They already have, it's quite clear that they have reached agreement on that, and they will actually do it earlier than what was the original proposal of the government. Gas distribution systems now, oil pipelines starting in January of 2015, of next year, and so on. You can see step by step when that will occur. And it's probably easier to see here. You can see more with some detail how the reform will evolve. And you see January 2015 as a critical date, because the new storage and distribution terminals of fuels will be opened up. all pipelines, facilities for logistic maritime terminals, and then dry gas production in 2015, also next year, production of mature fields in a new regime next year. And so you'll move along over time, and you can see in January 2018, domestic marketing of hydrocarbons. This is what nobody understands very well, why the government proposed it to be so far away, so towards the end of its administration. The administration of Mr. Peña Nieto ends up in 2018. So this is being amended, actually, by the Congress now to make it sooner rather than later. And then if you move to the left, you can see shale gas production in 2017, shale oil production, the Chicontepec Exploration and Production Project in 2017, and heavy oil E&P in shallow waters in 2017. It would be feasible as long as the government doesn't leave that for PEMEX. And this is what round zero looks like. What is what PEMEX requested from the government to keep in terms of exploration and production? You can see it in the top in terms of the reserves. What PEMEX keeps is in blue, and what the state would be able to actually grant to third parties in contracts or contract with third parties. In 3P's 29%, in 2P 17%, and so on. But it's more important if you see it in terms of the total of the three of those above is what in terms of prospective resources, PEMEX keeps only 31% or requested 31%. We don't know if the government is going to grant to PEMEX 31% or less than that, no? That they say you want this, but you are not going to keep it. And in prospective resources, you have 69% for the state that would be able to actually be contracted with private parties. And in terms of the type of, let me call it the type of field, you can see there the reserves and the percentage of the prospective resources that each of those are. The most important one are obviously in shallow waters. Deep waters is not bad. That's what is known, 8.1 billion of barrels of oil equivalent. And you can see that in terms of onshore, you basically, the prospective resources that will be available for the state to grant to private companies are equivalent to 82% of the known reserves. So I'll stop here, and then let's see how the conversation evolves. Thank you for your attention.
Pedro, thank you very much. I neglected to mention in my introduction of Pedro that about a year ago, you left McKinsey to join Hetco.
Yep.
And you're now current position as the head of advisory services for Hetco in New York. So thank
right.
you, Pedro.
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to start out by doing something shocking for somebody who spent 14 years at McKinsey. And I'm not going to speak off slides. You know, I'm not going to present any slides. So I apologize to my McKinsey educators who, you know, spent a lot of time teaching me how to draw slides, and I'm not going to use it. I think Jesus gave us a very complete, comprehensive overview. I'd like to, of the Mexican energy reform, I'd like to talk very quickly about a few points, and please stop me if I'm spending too much time. One is that the energy reform has been, to a large extent, public attention in Mexico and even political attention has been focused on the E&P part of the Mexican energy reform. And it's entirely natural because it's the most politically contentious part of the reform. It's the part that really required more than any other a review of the Constitution, and that has, you know, still to this day gets the juices flowing when you have discussions, political discussions, and discussions between analysts. However, the energy reform is quite comprehensive. It spans the entire energy sector. And there is a very interesting asymmetry between the attention that has been spent on exploration and production and the complexity of the reform. I don't want to you to understand by this that the EMP side is not complex and difficult, but the rest of the reform is enormously difficult and has a very large scope. So when you think about domestic fuels, you know, residential fuels like LPG or consumer fuels like gasoline and diesel, you think about the midstream and infrastructure, you think about residential power sales and distribution networks. All of those things are going to require a very significant overhaul, and the creation of that entire regulatory, legal, regulatory, and contractual framework is a massive work that is difficult to fathom. I'm not, again, belittling the importance of the EMP side, but just from an execution complexity, the non-EMP side of the reform is pretty big. The other issue that I'd like to focus on, I think the ambassador mentioned it, and I think we all agree with him that the reform is going to happen. Yes, it's been slipping by, you know, months or weeks, and we were told that it was going to be ready in, at the end of last year, and then it slipped into this year, and then we were told it was going to be done in June and July. You know, now it's end of July, perhaps the first few days of August, but it's going to happen. I don't think anybody has any doubts about that. The question is the amount of work that remains to be done in terms of once the legislation is passed. After that, we have to get the regulatory framework in place, and we have to get contracts in place. And more importantly than, you know, just getting these things done, there's got to be a continuum between the constitutional reform, the legislation, the secondary legislation, the regulation, and the contracts. All of that has to hang together in a way that, you know, kind of makes sense. The fundamental dilemma that I think the government and the regulators are going to find themselves trying to solve once the secondary legislation is passed, because I think we're at the point where whatever is going to be in the secondary legislation is pretty much defined, although there's still some discussion, is that if you leave the secondary legislation excessively open, and you rely to a large extent on the regulation, which the government can pass without having to go to Congress, you are putting a lot of weight on the authority of individual civil servants to take responsibility for decisions. It's going to be hard for them to kind of say, I'm just, you know, executing what the legislation has said. On the other hand, if you create a legislative structure that is excessively detailed, then you know you're not going to get it right, because nobody ever does, you know. You're going to have to make revisions. And so you don't want to have to go to Congress for that. And so there's a practicality and a practicality issue that where you have different you have tensions between different kinds of desirable outcomes, and it's a difficult balance to find. So this is going to take, you know, I'm not saying it's not going to be sorted out, but I think it's going to take weeks and months to get this just right. And I know for a fact that even though we've heard that, you know, all of those texts are ready, in fact, they're not. And, you know, thank God they're not, because I think they deserve a lot of attention. The other point I want to make is about operating challenges. PEMEX, and I'm going to focus on PEMEX because I spent 14 years there, and so it's what I know. So I apologize for not talking as much or, you know, not at all about the CFE. But PEMEX is a self-contained animal, and it's had operating, legal, regulatory discretionality. And so it can operate, you know, the assets, and it can make decisions to make whatever needs to happen happen. Let me give you an example. If you are producing offshore and you have several assets producing different kinds of crude offshore, and you have a pipeline system that is gathering that production and transporting it to shore, whether you shut one pipeline down or you open up the valves on one particular you know, field more to compensate for another that has to go into unscheduled maintenance, all of that can happen instantly, and PEMEX makes it happen to make the production reach 2.5 million barrels a day, which is what it's doing today. Now, the problem is if you take those pipelines and you turn them into open access common carrier pipelines, open access pipelines, now you have different producers, you know, that are connecting themselves to those pipelines possibly. And then, you know, PEMEX cannot just decide overnight that I've got to shut this pipeline down because, you know, I need to do some unscheduled maintenance on it. All of a sudden that has production consequences on other players. Now, take that example and multiply it across the entire PEMEX system. PEMEX is going to have to transition from a monopoly situation to a situation that is rule-driven. And it's not only because it's going to be competing, but because the authorities, particularly the CRE and the CNH, the two regulatory bodies, are going to create a series of rules. Now, you're not going to be able to have a system where these two regulatory bodies are, you know, credible in front of private sector investors when they are able to enforce the rules in front of, you know, enforce the rules for private sector investors and not for PEMEX. So this is going to create a lot of issues. Let me just show an example of this. Right now, we have an issue, and I have some numbers here that I can share as an example. PEMEX has a plan this year, it's the operating plan, to produce 2.5 million barrels a day. Well, along this production, and I'm not, you know, these are public figures, I'm not talking about, you know, secret figures or of any kind. If you compare production with distribution, distribution means refining plus export, you have differences of anywhere between 100 and 150,000 barrels a day, and that is water. And it's water that comes from the water cut in several areas of production, and particularly the Cantarell field. In the month of May, that number has reached about 260,000 barrels a day. There is it's a net number of about 150. And the difference is because there is a significant amount of production that has not been able to be processed either through separation or tankage, and has had to be injected into the salt domes in Tuzandépetl. And so that crude is going to be, you know, the water is going to be eventually separated, et cetera. But the water cut is increasing. So I have no idea whether this is a trend that's going to rise or whether it's going to stabilize. But 150,000 barrels a day of water declared as crude is a lot. And apparently, PEMEX is paying taxes on the 150,000 barrels a day of water. because it wants to do this in order to consider it crude oil production, because it wants to be able to report that it reaches the 2.5 million barrels a day. Now, this is a number that, you know, cannot continue like this. At some point, the government is going to have to recognize that this is water and not crude, and it's going to have to climb down from that number, which is, as I said, already there in the statistics, if you care to, you know, dig a little bit. So, you know, this issue with statistics becomes absolutely crucial when you have to introduce private sector actors into the picture. For example, we know that there's been some issues with investors in the incentive-based service contracts, where some of the baselines that PEMEX had originally given were proven not to be, you know, what they had been reported originally. In the future, when you're talking about farm outs, for example, with PSAs, if PEMEX goes ahead with some of these farm outs and some of the baselines prove not to be correct, then the private sector investor is going to litigate, because obviously, you know, the original data in the data room are not correct. So anyway, there's a big issue. All I want to say in this respect is that shifting from a state monopoly to a market solution is a very complex endeavor. And the managerial transition, in addition to the regulatory transition, the managerial transition for PEMEX is very difficult. And remember, some of these issues, as Jesus mentioned, like the tax, the budget issue, have not been changed. And particularly importantly, the labor relationship between PEMEX and its union has not been changed. So, you know, I fail to see at this point to visualize how this transition to a more efficient market-driven company is going to happen. I was also asked to mention how the energy reform was visualized by the private sector. Let me talk about one thing first, which is how it's visualized by the Mexican public opinion. Jesus also mentioned it, and I think the ambassador made a reference to it too. One key issue is that I think in general the public is not very keen on the energy reform. And it's not that it doesn't see the need to modernize PEMEX and CFE. I think the public is not stupid, and it recognizes that these companies need to improve. I think the key problem is that there is a fear of corruption, and there is a fear of ineptitude in the management of this transition, and there's a sense that whatever improvement is going to happen is not going to mean anything for me, the citizen. That those are the big issues that the government has. This is really important because, in my mind, the test of the success of the reform is not whether it brings gazillions of dollars flowing into Mexico. In fact, I disagree with the government vision that this is the thing that is going to bring, that is going to put the economy into a higher gear. But I think the key issue is the durability of the reform. And the durability means two things. First of all, credibility with private sector investors over the long run. And secondly, legitimacy in the eyes of the Mexican people. And achieving that balance over a long period of time, that is what is really complicated. And that's what's, you know, tough to achieve. Now, the second part of the impact is with private sector investors. And there, I think that you're going to see a wide variety of attitudes. I think deep water offshore, companies are pretty comfortable in the sense that they don't have to deal with any of the insecurities onshore. They can They understand more or less the geology because it's not too distant, particularly in some parts around Perdido, et cetera. It's not too distant from what they're already looking at on the other side of the border. And so I think the problem there is the actual drafting, the detail of the legislation, and the potential, the long-term potential that these companies can see there. And I think there you're going to have, I would guess that unless the regulators, the regulation and the contractual arrangements are suicidal, I think you're going to see a lot of interest. I think in unconventionals, it's going to be it's going to be complicated, and it's going to depend very much on a company-to-company basis. To me, the biggest danger there is that the regulatory, it's a Gresham's Law kind of problem. It's a situation where the good operators stay away and the not so good operators essentially, you know, manage the regulatory complexity, the security complexity, the water issues, et cetera. One of the big problems that we had in previous deregulation, like the gas deregulation, is the fact that we never really managed, the Mexican government never really managed to coordinate the federal, the state, and the local level. And so I could see a situation where, you know, you have your federal permit, you've earned your acreage, you show up with a drill rig, and the state authorities or the local authorities prevent you from drilling. And that's a big issue that is going to have to be addressed at some point. There are some mechanisms to do it, but I think it's got to be addressed in greater detail. I think the private sector, there's a little bit of a, and I'll finish on this point, there's a bit of a disconnect. I think there's a bit of a disappointment on the part of some people in the Mexican government because they feel that they would have expected a bit more enthusiasm from the private sector. And the private sector is now in a wait and see attitude. The problem is that if you're the head of business development or exploration for one of these companies, whether small, medium, or large, you have to propose to your investment committee or your executive committee or your board a project that is quantified and that is risk adjusted to the umpteenth level of detail. And that level of detail today is not known. So there are people who think that it's going to get done quickly. There are some people who think it's going to take, you know, a much longer, maybe 2-3 years to get there. There are some people who are going to be first off the, you know, the starting line, and there are some people who are going to wait and see to see how it evolves. So I think it's, you know, the timing is more or less the one that that Jesus described, but I think the actual implementation and details and, you know, translation into investment opportunities and decisions is going to be is still to be defined.
Okay. Thank you, Pedro. Senior Morse.
Thank you very much. It's an honor, privilege to be here again with you. And thanks, Guy, for the invitation. I was asked to address the implications for global markets of what might be unfolding in Mexico and what's unfolding north of Mexico and other parts of North America. And let me first note that so far, the unconventional revolution in the US and Canada has not been kind to Mexico. It is not as though the U.S. is intentionally or not following a good neighbor policy. It's been a pretty bad neighbor policy in terms of making the Gulf of Mexico market in the United States extremely competitive and less rewarding financially for PEMEX and the Mexican government, where if there were a big open global system that could process Mexican crude, undoubtedly the net back to Mexico would be higher, if not substantially higher. Than is currently received on the U.S. Gulf of Mexico coast. And I'll talk a bit about this as I go through the story there. The other thing I might note in terms of timing, and it's the only subject that I plan to raise outside of the implications for global markets, is that timing is pretty exquisite in terms of the potential opening of Mexico to foreign investment. If you are a big international oil company or an even more modest-sized international oil company and you're looking for a place to invest where there are opportunities for large-scale rewards, they are Canada, the United States, and the others are Russia, Iraq, and Iran. And that doesn't leave much room. So I think, given the light of geopolitics recently, that companies will find Mexico, with all of the difficulties of defining on a risk-adjusted basis, the risk-reward opportunities will likely be moving toward the acceptance of risk for the potential reward, just in terms of where else one can go. Mexican supply is the third leg of a North American energy revolution. I think we can debate, and we have to make assumptions on that debate about where Mexican output could go. Let's use kind of government general numbers, an increase in production of 500,000 barrels a day by the time of President Peña's end of term, and then maybe 1 million barrels a day by 2025. So that's a conservative number in terms of the resource base and in terms of what might be possible. Just looking across the divide in the Eagle Ford, where technically recoverable resources on the Mexican side exceed those on the U.S. side in the Eagle Ford, it would not take much if this were the United States to get onshore non-conventional production up to 500,000 barrels a day, let alone whatever might be happening on the conventional side. So let's use these as working numbers. Canadian production is likely to continue. These are quasi-official numbers based on the cap. So current production in Canada is roughly 3.5 million barrels a day, we can kind of readily project 5 million barrels a day adjusted for where the price of oil may be, but there's going to be an uplift as Canadian oil reaches waterborne markets in terms of the netback price to the wellhead, even if global prices falter. So in addition to the, say, 500,000 or 700,000 barrels a day maybe by 2020 from Mexico, there's another 1.5 million from Canada. And on the U.S. supply, our own view is that there's going to be around 4.3 million barrels a day more production by 2020 in comparison to the end of last year. 3.5 million of that is onshore, 800,000 offshore, mostly deep water, and in addition to that, some 2 million barrels a day of natural gas liquid. So if you add all of those things up, we see U.S. production having risen to a total of over 12.5 million barrels a day, maybe close to 19 million barrels a day, actually, if you add all of these things together in terms of increments, including NGL liquid. So this is a very robust, probably the fastest growing sustainable area of production growth in the world, and it's North American. I actually have used these slides in this room before. We just, on the U.S. side, see the net balance going positive on the U.S. Net oil side before the end of the decade, if you take into account where oil demand is going. So we see the oil and gas trade balance combined becoming net positive by 2020. I know Guy talked about North American self-sufficiency, as did Jesus a little bit, but I think the real issue is the Atlantic Basin versus the rest of the world, because the Atlantic Basin is already a self-sufficient environment. That's a result of decline in European refinery requirements and the growth of North American production, growth of Western Hemisphere production in general. Any growth from now on is going to make the Atlantic Basin a surplus area. If you just look at the supply demand balances in the Atlantic Basin, and that means there's a lot of crude oil coming into the Atlantic Basin that is kind of trapped there. I'll talk about it very quickly. The Atlantic Basin crude deficit really is fading so fast that it's likely to end by the end of this year. The U.S. has pushed out almost completely imports from Africa. We are pushing out imports from the Middle East. But the problem is not by enough, because imports from the Middle East still are well above 1,400,000 barrels a day. And by the time we get to the end of this year and have pipeline capacity to bring Canadian crude to the US Gulf Coast, that reliance on crude from outside of the Atlantic Basin is going to fade substantially. We can talk about US export restraints loosening. To the degree there is a loosening of US export constraints, it'll feed into a growing surplus in the Atlantic Basin. And I've also used part of this slide in this room before, indicating in our own view that under the current regime for oil exports, the US, if not by the end of this year, certainly by this time next year, without any change in policy, will be exporting probably over 1 million barrels a day of crude oil, and we'll see Canadian crude coming into the US through increased pipeline capacity in the mid-continent of the US, bringing crude to the US Gulf Coast, where it will compete with crude oil from Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Venezuela, Colombia, Mexico, and Iraq, which practically sees no crude oil imports. Already, Mexican crude oil exports to the US is falling even more than production is falling, because there's not enough room in the US Gulf refining system to refine all of the crude oil coming from Mexico. We're seeing diversion of crude to Europe and to the Pacific Basin, where, again, the pipeline at Salinas Cruz has been exporting into the Pacific Basin, including into the US West Coast in growing numbers. The real place where crude oil exports are needed from the Americas is really Asia, where the deficit currently around 21 million barrels a day is going to grow to probably 24 million barrels a day by the end of this decade, if not more. And Mexico is no exception, looking increasingly to Asia and Europe. One of the other places that one can find incremental North American crude going into the Pacific Basin is from Canada, but pipeline politics in Canada are very difficult, and it looks as though we'll see significant amounts of crude oil from Alberta moving east to the Atlantic Basin by pipe and rail, and south to the Gulf of Mexico by pipe and rail, and not taking advantage of the higher netbacks that can be realized in the Pacific Basin. So Mexican crude may be the only North American crude to take advantage of that. But here's the summary of what I would say. By 2020, the three North American producers could see combined incremental growth of liquids of 8.3 million barrels a day, the bulk of that coming out of the US, combined with new exports out of the KRG from Iraq and from Central Asia. The already crowded Med is going to become more crowded. The already self-sufficient North Atlantic and South Atlantic basins are going to become surplus. Oil will want to get out of this area toward other countries. The problem is worsened by the fact that some of the exporters to the Western Hemisphere, Saudi Arabia and Kuwait, have their exports relatively sticky on the Saudi side because they don't want to lose market share in a big market and rely on East Asia and South Asia for market growth. Kuwait, because they believe that exporting 330,000 barrels a day to the US Gulf Coast market, however non-remunerative it may be, helps them keep 15,000 US troops there. So there's a sticky amount of oil that won't leave the Atlantic Basin, making it more difficult for the crude produced in both Mexico and Canada to achieve a kind of fair market value in a global marketplace. And even though Canadian crude is likely to have the highest netbacks it might have by exporting to the Pacific. That's not likely to be the case. Any liberalization of U.S. crude oil exports is going to even make the Atlantic Basin market more crowded. So the challenge for Mexico today, exacerbated by a growth of 500,000 a day maybe by 2018, 700 or 800 by 2020, and a minimum of a million by 2025, is where to maximize value, where to optimize the maximization of value of that crude oil, and it looks like that won't be easy. Anyway, thanks for the opportunity to share this little addendum to the other remarks.
Thank you, Ed. Well, thanks to all three of our speakers for a comprehensive overview of the reform by Jesus, and I think a very sobering, realistic view of the challenges from faced by the implementation that Pedro outlined, and then Ed's view of how these might affect the global market. And one thing I say about Ed is I look at those numbers and I say, it looks like it's going to be, you know, a challenge to get those into the market without causing downward pressure on price. But when you think about all of the uncertainties we're now facing, even though the 2020 still weighs out, with the uncertainty in Iraq, Iran, Nigeria, et cetera, I think I'm glad that we do have these potential new sources of supply, because we're probably going to need them. And with that, I know we're getting tight on time, so I want to go right to Q's and A's. Please identify yourself and your affiliation, and keep your questions as concise as possible. I appreciate it.
Hello. Hi, I'm Dr. Donna Wells. I'm an expert in the Russian language internet, but I also happen to be a native Texan. We're reading about mass graves and heads on pikes down there. Should private investors be concerned about cartel violence or possible growth in political power of the cartels? Thank you.
Hey, don't you? You're a cartel expert.
Yeah, I certainly am. I think that there are parts of Mexico where you will have to contend with these issues. And some of the companies present there, like Schlumberger, Halliburton, Baker Hughes, already are. I was told recently that Control Risk, that manages the security risk for Schlumberger, rates northern Mexico along, you know, on the same level as southern Iraq. Although that was before, you know, the situation we have right now in Iraq. So, but I do think that there's some issues that the companies are facing. Now, when you talk to some of the players, they tell you, well, you know, I'm in Yemen, I'm in Nigeria, I think I can deal with northern Mexico. So it's not that they disregard the security issues, but it's that oil companies are a pretty hardy lot. And some of them, not all of them, interestingly, I mean, if you're an operator in South Texas or West Texas, and you're going to Mexico for the first time ever, it's going to be a little bit of an issue, and you're going to need to find crews that are willing to go to Mexico, et cetera, which you might not. On the other hand, if you're, you know, let's say an Oxy, for example, I mean, Oxy is in pretty rough places. Total is in pretty rough places. So are they going to feel comfortable there? Not comfortable, but do they think they can manage it? I think they can. There's another dimension which, you know, everybody focuses on the security issue. I think there's also big issues in terms of community relations. And this is a big issue that happened when we were talking about the gas reform. Because PEMEX has ways of dealing with this that are not necessarily open to the private sector. And in areas, for example, onshore in the south of Mexico, in Tabasco, Chiapas, you have a lot of community relations issues. I understand that there's one particular service contract that is operated by Schlumberger where they haven't been able to operate the first day, you know? They haven't been able to go in at all. So those are issues that are gonna have to be dealt with, no doubt.
Maybe we could take a couple questions, starting with the one here, and then any over on this side, and Annette will be second.
Stephen Donahue from McLarty Associates. I'd like to pick up on something that Mr. Haas said and ask Dr. Reyes Heroles a question based on his experience as the Director General of PEMEX. Given that you have an entrenched bureaucracy in PEMEX that's used to doing things in a certain way, and that now the rules are changing, that takes away a lot of that authority and power and ability to act as a monopoly, and also in CFE, how do you think that transition is going to go, and how long is it going to take before you reset the mindset of these people that have been used to running things for so long, and what's the impact of that on retention of these mid and senior level executives in those institutions?
Thank you. Annette's question, then we'll answer them both.
Hi, Annette Hester, Inter-American Development Bank. Hi. I was just wondering, I didn't hear much about environmental assessment impacts, and I've noted in several other jurisdictions that you move one reform ahead, but you also need all the environmental approvals to be able to move several projects ahead. How do you see that working out together with the community approval and so on for several of the projects?
Thank you. Jesus, maybe you could answer the question about PEMEX and then whoever.
Well, I think that PEMEX cannot be changed from within. I mean, I probably am a living proof of that, no? So it needed a major shakeup. And it had to come from outside. This does the trick, obviously, this reform, because it really puts PEMEX in competition in every aspect of the whole chain. Now, the big issue is, I think that from within PEMEX, if you sort of, obviously the top management is convinced of the reform, and they are working for it. The issue is how successful they will be to implement the changes within the company so that PEMEX is able to cope with competition, and at the same time, by doing so, allowing a significant and rapid expansion of the hydrocarbon sectors of Mexico. Actually, a lot of companies really want to go to Mexico partnering with PEMEX. But there might arise some questions related with the capacity of PEMEX to be a good partner. So, which in turn has to do with the regulations and with the Treasury and the way the Treasury is going to treat PEMEX. I think that the critical issue is that within PEMEX, some of the most important layers of executives, the guys who are in the fields, the supervisors, they accept the notion of eliminating the exclusivity of PEMEX. There was a very important discussion about this in relation with the reform of 2008. It was in 2008 when actually the taboo of discussing these issues was eliminated, because there was a taboo. I mean, in 2006, when I entered into, I became the CEO there, it was a prohibition to actually talk about the opening of PEMEX or the opening of the sector. This is only, you know, six years ago. It's a completely different ballgame now, no? And everybody discusses that, every political party includes this topic in their agenda and so on. So I think my perception is this layer of executives do accept the fact that the exclusivity had to go, and that PEMEX had to compete with other companies. But, and it's a very important but, in a level playing field. And it's there where the fact that they not took PEMEX out of the budget and the, I would say, excessive intrusion of the Treasury in many of the decisions of PEMEX creates a problem. Because some of those middle layers and high layers functionaries are completely unhappy with that. They say, okay, you want, and we want PEMEX to compete, let us compete. But do not put us in an unlevel playing field. If you really make an assessment, I think that the big loser of the reform as it is PEMEX, paradoxically, because it, one would say that within the mind of the government, strategically thinking, they need to understand that they need PEMEX to be the dominant company for quite some time, some years, for the country and the sector to keep moving ahead. There is the other thing is impossible to imagine that you pass from day one to day two and the monopoly is gone and everything else is done by somebody else. So, and that is not, in my mind, is not clear that they really get it, that it's a complicated thing and they have to put a lot of attention to that so as not to become an impairment of the reform. I would sort of, there are other aspects, the taxing aspects and other things, but I leave it here. No.
Thank you. In answering Annette Hester's question, is the environmental protection regulations, are they part of this secondary legislation or are they a different?
Well, actually, the constitutional reform did include the creation of a commission on security issues. I mean, not security, safety, labor safety issues and environmental aspects in the energy industries. And it will become a new agency. And I would say in terms of the safety, PEMEX has made a lot of strides over the past years. So I have no concern with that. Actually, it's, if you see the records of PEMEX as compared with other national oil companies, PEMEX does very well. The issue is the environmental, and the environmental has to do, I'm not very concerned about current operations of PEMEX in regard to the environmental impact. There are some, as every company in the world has, but if you see the standards at which PEMEX operates currently, they are relatively high standards. The question has to do more with the issue of shale operations. How will all the discussion that is really going on in the US and in other corners of the world in regard to that permeate and be dealt with in Mexico by the agency and by public opinion and by the government? That, I think, is a critical issue. Now, there is an important difference. If you saw the map that Ed actually presented here, it's very interesting that some of the areas where there is potential for shale operations in Mexico, exploitations in Mexico, are on the coastal areas. And that makes a big difference in regard to the issue of water. Because there are some in the Coahuila, not just bordering with the US in the very north, it's a dry area, but as soon as you move a little bit further south, including some of Tamaulipas and especially in Veracruz, there's a lot of water. It's a completely different thing. Now, you're not going to pollute the water. The issue is what techniques do you use to actually return the water used in these explorations to the in the same conditions that they were taking from nature. And that will, there's the good thing is that there is a lot of way that has been already, well, progress that has been made here and in the US with technologies and with the know-hows of how to do that. That Mexico will benefit just by sort of receiving the know-how with the investors that would be interested in doing that. And the downside of that is that most probably there will be a contamination of the discussion because the ONGs that discuss these issues are transnationals and they would clearly bring raise the issues down there. There's already starting an interesting debate about those issues. So those are the ones that, I'm not talking about the air, that's a different, emissions of CO2 or something like that, that's different. I'm talking more about the water issues.
Okay, we've got three more questions. I think that's going to have to wrap it up because I know two of our speakers have tight travel schedules, one, and then there are two more over here.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Cesar Rosales from Georgetown University. There have been many comments about the excess of optimism in the goals and benefits from the energy reform very recently. The Oxford Institute, with that, which I believe Mr. Haas is somewhat familiar to this because it was a paper recently released that was highlighting the lack of services for deep water exploration, that the new fields would hardly offset the production in mature fields, and one of the current PEMEX counselors said that the government should address in the secondary regulations, in the secondary legislation, whether the country should follow a model of production with a dominant regulator or a dominant producer. And my personal view in international aspects is that the discussion about international prices, self-sufficiency, which does not necessarily mean independence from markets, because we recently saw the instability of prices with the Iraq war. So in this context, how will the Mexican government will address and will try to attract and retain foreign investment?
Thank you. And the other two more, and then we'll finish.
Hi, I'm Jason Kleinerman. I'm a student at Penn State University. I was wondering if the panel could elaborate more on the fiscal structure of the proposed exploration and production contracts, and also what are Pemex's strategies relating to them diversifying their international trading partners, and what role do U.S. and Chinese firms play in this investment?
Hi, good afternoon. I'm doing an internship here in a consulting company, but I'm a Mexican citizen. So I'm going back to Mexico, and Mr. Haas mentioned that there are a lot of questions in between Mexican people about how this reform is gonna give me a benefit as a Mexican citizen. As far as I know, the taxes that Pemex pay, it's about a 40% annually for the Mexican budget. So I think that, if we bring new companies that are going to actually sell this same product that Pemex sells, I think so Pemex sales are going to drop. And if Mexico is inviting other companies to invest in Mexico, I think Mexico needs to offer something that is attractive. So my question is whether these companies are going to pay the same amount of taxes that Pemex paid, or if not, where is this money this money that Pemex is going to start producing, how Mexico is going to produce this money, or where is this money coming from?
Okay, thank you. Ed, maybe you can answer the global. Can you have time? The one about... Okay.
Let me start with the fourth, and then we go backwards, if that's okay. No, because I think the fourth is very important.
Okay.
The guidelines that are in the secondary legislation about how the contracts will be are very similar to the international guidelines. There are a couple of issues, but there are like four variables that the government will actually move when crafting the contracts with the private parties in terms of granting them a permit or a license to exploit some areas. I think the bottom line of all these discussions is the following. Mexico will have to have a competitive contract scheme, because the otherwise would be an absurdity in the context of the reform. You make the reform because you want more investment, both private and public, into the hydrocarbon sector. It's not bringing private investment instead of PEMEX's investment, because that would then it would be a sum zero game. You need to keep PEMEX investing and to bring other players in competition or in partnership with PEMEX to bring additional resources so that you can multiply the number of wells being drilled and the installations and the facilities being constructed and so on. So the contract, the taxing aspect of those contracts will have at the end of the day to be competitive to international with international standards, corrected by risk and all the factors that have to be considered. So that is the basic point. It doesn't matter which one of those four variables they move. That depends a lot of if the government is eager to get some resources sooner than later, or if they are willing to sacrifice some resources, some income from those contracts in the short term for the future. And then you can do all sorts of plays with that and models and all that. But the bottom line is the number at the end that the government take, that Mexico's government is going to take from the contracts that will be negotiated with private parties and with PEMEX will have to be internationally competitive. And that the clarity is there. There are some other issues that maybe the scheme is a little bit too complex because the Treasury wants to have an opinion in each contract, things like that, bureaucracy, no? That in my view is not needed and should be done in a more systemic way. But those are secondary. The issue is the competitiveness of the Mexican scheme vis-a-vis the others. I don't know if with that I respond to your question. Okay.
I have a complimentary take on this. I think that one of the issues that the government faces is the selection of the assets that it wants to put on the block and the sequencing. That's really important. Let me just give you an example to stop speaking conceptually. Let's say that you start the auction with deep water offshore in areas where PEMEX has actually, it says it has found something, but it's uncertain how much, and there's no 1P reserves, and the prospectivity is kind of doubtful. Well, you have a 10 to 12 year span between discovery and first oil. You have very low prospectivity. You have, some seismic data, but not really a lot. So you're taking a lot of risk. And if you want to go into that, if you want to start your auctioning of acreage that way, you're going to get, very few players because there's not too many people who play in the Paleogene. That's very ultra deep water. And there's low prospectivity and there's a lot of risk and, a very long life cycle to first oil. Now, if you start, on the other hand, with, and nobody knows what the energy reform is going to look like and what are the issues, all of that remains to be tested. So you're starting with very high risk stuff and with a very uncertain practical application of the reform. Now let's say that you do it otherwise. You say, I'm going to go to shallow waters offshore. I'm going to auction the block that's between Kumalopsab and Cantarell and Apkatun, right, those blocks right there. Prospectivity is very high. There's a lot of hydrocarbons. And if you're an oil man, where do you look for oil? Where there's already oil. And so you have shallow waters, which are very easy to operate in. It's 150 feet of draft. You have a lot of undersea infrastructure because the pipelines, were designed for 3.5 million barrels a day, and you're now at 2.5 million barrels. It's relatively low risk in comparison to ultra deep water. So the amount of money that people are willing to pay for that acreage, the enthusiasm that you're going to have for that acreage is a lot higher. So it doesn't only depend, I agree with what Jesus was saying, but it doesn't only depend on the marginal tax rate and the royalty rate, et cetera. It also depends on how you want to start. And I know that Pemex gets ulcers when thinking that the Mexican government could auction blocks in shallow waters, you know, offshore, because that's their turf and that's where they think they have a chance. But the question is, if you're thinking about the development of the Mexican oil sector and you're thinking of attracting foreign investors, if it was my money, I would start with shallow waters. And then you prove the concept, you bring in people with low risk issues, and you're gonna have a lot of competition. You have many more companies that can operate in that environment. And once you prove the concept and you start, you know, filing the, you know, sanding the rough edges, then you get a much sturdier legal infrastructure and regulatory infrastructure. You've proven the concept, and then you can move on to more complicated areas. So there's a big decision on the part. I have no idea what they're going to decide. You know, I'm not privy to those discussions. But they have to make design discussions. They have to make sequencing discussions. They have to make decisions based on sequencing, based on how much they're going to give to Pemex, you know, of that request that Jesus was talking about, and all of that is going to have an impact on the unfolding of the reform.
Does the changing situation in North America have a change the policy goals or the targets about where Mexico would sell that oil now? I mean, is that, I think the one questioner asked whether that new oil will be going to China or,
I mean, is that, listen, I learned, it's gonna go where the I market learned many years ago. I spent 12 years in international trade, and then I consulted for many companies worldwide on international trade issues. You know, crude oil is cash, basically. Okay, there is no problem.
I remember that hedging.
Yes, there is no problem with selling crude oil. The only question is at what price you're going to sell it, and that has two dimensions to it. One is the efficiency. You know, are you getting the market price? You're not going to get more than the market price. You have to be careful not to get less than the market price. And the second is whether you're maximizing the netback because you're going to the right market, you know. That's all there is. Now, PMI, I think, has the international trade subsidiary of Pemex, has the capability, analytical and commercial, to market the crude oil wherever it makes the most money. It's the question of whether Mexican energy policy will give it the freedom to execute whatever sales strategy is needed to maximize the return. But that's all there is. I don't think there's any particular mystery in it.
Okay. Did your question get answered?
Yeah, it was partly answered by the expectations of production and prices.
Okay.
My question was more into the excessive optimism and which were your views on whether the government meet the production goals by 2018?
I don't think they're going to meet. I mean, the government has a 3 million barrel a day goal by the end of this administration. The number is not 2.5 million current production, it's 2,350,000, as I mentioned, and plus you have the decline, and to make up for that, I just don't think that they're gonna be able to reach 3 million barrels a day. Now, I think there's another issue, which is that one of the problems we have is that the government, I believe, from the very beginning, because it had all these political constraints and it had to make sure that the whole legislation would pass, et cetera, has been making a lot of commitments and promises, you know, volumes of production, declining prices to the public, et cetera. I just don't think those are tenable. And I don't think people believe them. And I think the government can get in trouble because it promises things that it is going to have a hard time delivering. Does that mean that it invalidates the reform? I don't think it invalidates the reform. This is a very ambitious, complicated reform. It's going to take some years to get done and polished and executed in a way that, you know, has never been done in Mexico. And so it's normal that we're going to have bumps in the road. The problem is if you promise that there's not going to be any bumps and then there are bumps, people are going to say, oh, you lied to me. Come on. I mean, you know.
The exceeded expectations is part of the process of selling the reforms. Every government, when tries to push for a reform, regretfully falls into promising things that are too optimistic. And that happened also with the energy reform in Mexico. And it has different implications in Mexico and outside. So the issue here is managing the expectations, because the reform is a very serious, a very profound reform. You already, the government finally, after 70 years of discussion in Mexico, actually made a ball of snow that put on the top of a mountain, and the ball is rolling. And it's going to be a heck of a huge ball when it gets down. So let's not hope, let's not lose hope, not hope, but perspective of that. That is true. Now, bumps and non-bumps, expectations that feel frustrated in the short term and changes and so on, that will happen. But it's a reality. I want to add one element in regard to that, if you allow me, Guy, because one has to also be confident about the capacity of Mexico to deal with that. Just think about the changes in the energy, in the gas reform of 94, 96, whatever. I mean, at the end of the day, it did work. It took time, the regulations were there. NAFTA, before that, NAFTA is a reality, and institutions are there. I mean, the country has been able to build up the institutions that are needed to implement big changes like that. So, and the country is an open country. So there are many questions if the Mexican economy will have the capacity to respond to a very, you know, demanding, high demand for labor. And you talked about that, for labor and supplies and companies and engineering capacities and so on. And the response is Mexico by itself, no. But it's an open economy. And just, you have very close, it's a NAFTA member, and you have the US and Canada right there. So with that, the capacity of Mexico, I'm not concerned about the capacity of Mexico to respond in that aspect of it, no? Now regulations, you can have regulations of 10, 9, 8, 5, so, I mean, you can rate them, but it's there.
I have a problem there, and this is a discussion we might need to have, you know, at a later date. But I think the gas regulation, to me, and I was CEO of Pemex Gas when it happened, is exactly the example that we have to avoid. We had constitutional reform, we had regulatory reform, we created the CRE, we had all the bells and whistles, and I think the reform failed. And the proof that the reform failed is that the economy has had gas alerts, gas supply alerts, and that it has been impossible to build the infrastructure to supply Mexico with the gas. And that's the thing that we have to avoid. We have to avoid a regulatory and legal and regulatory environment that does 95% of the work and then falls short of the last 5% that you need to actually execute the point. And there is that risk. I think it's going to work, but I think it's going to be complicated. And I think there is the risk in this particular case that we also fall short because of X, Y, or Z, just like we did at the time of the gas reform. I hope it's not the case, but it's a complicated issue. And I think that unless we're very, very aware that it may happen to us again, I think we run the risk that it will. If we are aware that it happened to us, and that we are able to go back and see what went wrong and we avoid the same mistakes, I think then we have a better chance. But it's not that easy. It's not, you know, a piece of cake.
Okay. Well, thank you all.